Hi and welcome to Access Chat. We're really, really pleased to have Jay Ruderman here with us today. Jay is the lead for the Ruderman Charitable Foundation, which, if you don't know about it, works to deliver access and inclusion at both in the United States and in Israel. And we're covering topics like philanthropy and how to bring about positive change in how we include people with disabilities in innovation and in society. So I want to thank you, Jay, for taking time out of your busy schedule to join us today. Really good to have you here.
And thank you.
I know that you've got a lot that you can teach us. So I know that you've been working with Deborah before. So I'm going to plunge straight on in and ask you to give us a bit of background about the foundation, because I've read up about you, but our followers may not have done. So can you explain how the foundation came about and what the core aims of the organization are?
Well, the foundation is based in Boston, and we work on the issue of inclusion of people in our society in all aspects of life. I think for us, it started out as an issue of fairness as our family. You know, why are some people included in society and some people not included? And we've expanded from that really globally to not only fund innovation in terms of inclusion and employment and living in the community and education and community life, but also in advocacy. We focus a lot on when people speak out and use poor terms referring to people with disabilities. When people with disabilities are treated badly in society, we generally respond pretty quickly to those incidents.
Okay, so the innovation stuff I'm really interested in. I know that you sponsor a number of initiatives, including you sponsoring effectively like an innovation fund. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, we know that people with disabilities are the largest minority in the world, roughly 20% of the population. And we know that, for example, in the United States, roughly 70% of people with disabilities are unemployed. So for example, in the area of employment, we've started a program called Transitions to Work in Boston that's partnered with several community organizations and also with the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. The advantage of this program is it trains people with disabilities at a particular job site, like for example, at a hospital where the jobs exist on the other end. But that program didn't really have the success that it's gained until we really focused on employers. And we have noticed that when the employer is engaged, when they've valued having an inclusive workforce, that's when it really takes off. And then they talk to their other colleagues, whether they're in the hospital industry or food service or whatever the industry is, that's the real success. So we've tried to generate changing attitudes in the business community. And we've done that in other areas, in housing and in education. But I'm a true believer in leadership, whether it's a CEO or whether it's a principal or headmaster of a school, or whether it's a political leader. We really need that leadership in order to change the dynamic on inclusion.
So effectively, the foundation's acting as the catalyst for the change. You're injecting in resource into areas where you can see that there's leadership, and you can see that there's a bit of a vacuum. So it's an effective way of bringing that change forward, I guess.
Well, I think if you look at philanthropy, I think no social problem can be solved by philanthropy alone. I don't care if you're the Gates Foundation or the wealthiest person in the world. Partnerships are key to change. So you need government, you need community leaders, you need all aspects of society in order to create change. I think philanthropy, you can provide some seed funding and invest in innovation and maybe push the government in a direction that they may not have gone otherwise. But alone, we can't change the dynamic. And I think also with this issue of inclusion of people with disabilities, we really need leadership. So we try to provide the innovation that allows others to step forward and say this is a priority for society.
Excellent, thank you. So I'm very much in agreement with you that this has to be a collaborative effort, because effectively what we're dealing with is society, which is a very, very complex system or complex series of systems. So you can't just throw money at a problem, because there are knock-on effects throughout society, and disability is a mega trend. It's one of the things that's going to be affecting society for decades and decades to come, particularly due to the demographics, certainly in the West, certainly in Europe and America, where you've got rapidly aging populations. We need to find ways of dealing with it, and governments need to know that. So when you're looking at technology, because I do believe that technology has a key role to play in this, what are the things that you are looking for when you are selecting partners to work with?
Well, regarding technology, and we've been involved in some support of technology, and recently sponsored a fair in Israel on this issue that was sort of, I guess, could be described as a hackathon. You're looking at technology that makes accessibility happen. So for example, there was we were involved in this project in Israel with an organization called Present Tense that got together a group of 40 high-tech innovators. And one of the projects that came out of that is a company called Sesame Enable. So Sesame Enable allows someone who cannot use their hands on a...
I've seen the Sesame, it's great.
Right, that they can, with their eyes, be able to access their smartphone. And as we all know, smartphones are sort of... needed in terms of daily life in order to access society. So that was one project that came out of that. I mean, I think we were looking for technologies that allow people to work, allow them to live in the community, allow them to be part of society. And there's so many different ideas out there. The other thing is that we have to try to elevate. I mean, my community is the philanthropic community, but we have to elevate this issue and make it more real to society. I look at this issue of inclusion as a civil rights issue. This is one of the largest minorities in the world. It is a community that has routinely has their civil rights ignored, routinely has been segregated through separate education, segregated housing, unemployed or involved in sheltered workshops. So to change that dynamic, we have to point out to society that people with disabilities have their rights ignored and try to make it important for society. I do believe that networks are important. I do believe that people with disabilities, as a community, tends to be a fractured community. We tend to organize based on our disability, whether it be autism or Down syndrome or whatever the issue is. That we don't join together as a community, but if the disability community did join together as a community, I think it would be a very powerful voice that society could not ignore.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely spot on. That's one of the things that we're clear about at AXSChat, is that we're not representing one disability. We're representing pan-disability. It's and all abilities and all ranges of abilities, because we've also seen that fragmentation and that fracturing and that dilutes the message. It weakens us as a cohort to be able to bring about significant change. So Deborah, I know you've got a question for Jay, so can I hand you over?
Yeah, thank you. And Jay and I met each other on social media, and I started noticing, some of the chatter that was coming from the Ruderman Foundation and from Jay. And I was fortunate enough to get to interview Jay and do a blog about him, because he, as he mentioned, he is a leader, and I'm really glad, you know, that Jay and I know each other. But I just wanted to go a little bit more into something you said, Jay, about the employers. One thing that I have found in my work is that the same thing that you have found, that if the employers are not meaningfully included in part of these conversations, we're not going to have the real outcomes. And I was very impressed to learn of the actual employment outcomes that are coming out of programs that the Ruderman Foundation are funding and partnering on. I also thought it was very interesting that, and so tell me if I'm saying this incorrectly, Jay, but the Ruderman Foundation doesn't really, you decide who you're going to fund and who the partners are, as opposed to people just submitting, you know, funding papers and things like that. You take a more interactive approach, which seems to be working because you're having a lot more success than anyone else that we're seeing in the field, and really from a global perspective. So I was wondering, and also, sort of three questions altogether, Jay. I know recently y'all awarded awards to employers and organizations that were meaningfully including people with disabilities in their workforce, and I really applauded those efforts. So I really am proud of the leadership that you as the CEO and the Ruderman Foundation are doing to change this conversation.
Right. So, yeah, we do not accept unsolicited requests. We tend to look for innovative programs and fund them. On employment, we're very proud of a program in Boston called Transitions to Work, although we've also worked on employment in Israel. I really think the employer is key. If you look at certain corporations that have excelled in hiring people with disabilities, whether it be the Marriott Corporation, hotel chain, or pharmaceutical companies, or pharmacies like CVS or Walgreens, the leadership often comes from the top. And what we're trying to do is either notice that leadership or trying to develop that leadership. The program that you're talking about, where we just recognize businesses, was called the Best in Business campaign that we did with a major Jewish newspaper in New York called the Jewish Week. And we've selected, or a committee selected 10 employers across North America that have really excelled at employing people with disabilities. What we're trying to do there is to show the general business community that hiring people with disabilities should be a priority. And we make the case for it that not only are they doing the right thing, but their people with disabilities are among the most loyal employees, and you're creating a workforce that people feel good about being part of workforce when people with disabilities are there. I'll tell you a short story that I was at a graduation for our Transitions to Work program, and so I saw people with disabilities getting their first job and their families, and they were all excited about it. But the hospital workers who are mentoring these young people with disabilities were in tears because this was the most meaningful thing that they had ever done at their job. And many employers recognize that. They also recognize the buying power of people with disabilities. If we're talking about 20% of the population and their families, you know, highlighting the employment of people with disabilities is also good business practice.
In terms of recruitment, sometimes, you know, a lot of companies end up outsourcing their services, and recruitment agencies have a huge role in the way how people go into the workforce. How do you see that from your perspective, and how the fact that sometimes recruitment agencies are not as, you know, open to this type of topics, how can they change, or how can they improve the way how they work in order to be more alert for the importance of hiring people with disabilities?
Well, first of all, I think people with disabilities have to be their own best advocates. They have to speak up to employment agencies and to companies and to say that we have a right to be employed, and to raise the issue higher on the agenda of these agencies. There's enough, as Deborah knows, there's enough proof out there that the employment of people with disabilities is not all that expensive and not all that complicated. It's often a mindset of people that have grown up with the issue of segregation and not thinking of people with disabilities as employable. When I talk to you or to the world, I'm essentially representing my family and our mission. However, the issue is much, much broader than any of us. So one of the things that we're doing this fall in November in Boston is holding a major summit. We're calling it the Ruderman Inclusion Summit. We're hoping to bring together 500 people or more that will come together, learn best practices. But the idea of this summit is that we'll create a network, and the network will keep expanding of people with disabilities and their families. And as their voice grows, I don't think that voice can be ignored by society.
I think that's a fantastic idea. I think that building upon the point that Antonio made and thinking about large businesses, the recruitment agencies are only the agents of the businesses that are procuring their services. So again, it's a leadership thing, whereby if the leaders of the businesses that are engaging the recruitment agencies make it clear that they are open to employing people with disabilities, the agencies will do their bidding. We know that this to be the case in our own organization. We've dictated the fact that we have a policy which is called Two Ticks, which is a British government policy, which means that anyone that declares that they have a disability that meets the minimum criteria automatically gets an interview. And although we outsource all of our entire recruitment process, that still stands. So we still get to interview people with disabilities, and they can still get through the recruitment process. But people do have to come forward, and they have to disclose. Like you say, they have to be their best advocate. So there is the issue of disclosure, which is something that we've discussed week after week, don't we, Deborah?
Yes.
So there was another question, and it's slipping my mind. That's my own disability. My short-term memory is rubbish. I've got dyslexia, so there's my disclosure. So interested about the training on site and the stuff that you're doing there. I know what it was, and it was the fact that you're working across different cultures, and there are some significant differences to implementing disability solutions, especially when it's technology in Semitic languages. So this is something that we're coming across on the W3 task force, where you're thinking about how you lay out websites. How do you make something for cognitive difficulties when people think from right to left or left to right? Is this something that your foundation encounters a lot of, because you're crossing the cultural divide?
Well, I think that successful programs need to come from the ground up. You need to learn from people's own experiences and people's own cultures and their own communities. We try to turn to a group of people with disabilities to advise us wherever we operate, whether it's in the United States or whether it's in Israel or other parts of the world, and learn from that culture. Because the people on the ground, people with disabilities who are employed or living in the community, whatever the aspect is, they know best how they're accessing the community. And that's really where their power is. One of the things about the disability community as opposed to other communities is the number of issues that a person with disability or their families face is just sort of overwhelming. So I understand why the organization doesn't come about as rapidly as it may have in other communities. But I do think that societies are ripe for this change. I mean, if you look in the United States on the issue of marriage equality and really how quickly that advanced and that became embraced by the vast majority of society, and even if it wasn't embraced, you couldn't stand in the way of it. I think that can certainly happen with this issue here. a lot of it is changing attitudes. You'll find leaders in either businesses or government or wherever they may be have a person with a disability. In fact, when I speak, I often ask people in the audience how many people have either a family member or a neighbor or a friend with any form of a disability, or they themselves, and every hand will go up in the audience. And I've also heard it described that disability is one minority group that all of us someday will join. And so it's so widespread, but the issue is really an attitude. If you have an attitude that someone should be segregated, that separate but equal is legitimate, then it's hard to advance. But when you point out to people that separate but equal is not really considered acceptable, then change starts to occur. So I agree with you. I think each society is different, but sort of the issues facing people with disabilities, their lack of inclusion in society, that's universal.
Yeah, I think there's commonality, but some of the technicalities may be different. So Deborah, I know you've got another question.
Yes, something that something Jay and I had talked about that I thought was very intriguing is it's being in the field for about 15 years now, I can't really think of another person like Jay that's in these conversations. He's a CEO of a very large foundation, and he's looking at this issue from a lot of different levels. He's being very vocal on social media, and I know that I've seen some of his opinion pieces that have come over Huffington Post. So what I've pondered with Jay is, how do we get more Jay Ruddermans into these conversations? How do we get more investors and philanthropists and really joining the conversation in a more meaningful way? I know that Jay has been a real leader when it comes to the Jewish community of, making sure that part of his community also, are joining these conversations in a meaningful way. But I was just wondering, Jay, if you could just talk about how do we get the other Jay Ruddermans and involved in these conversations in a more meaningful way, the other investors and philanthropists and funders.
Well, I think, as I discussed about, framing the issue as a civil rights issue or as a social justice issue, I think will connect with many people out there. The problem is often people look at disability as a charity issue. So here's people who are maybe less fortunate than us, and we have to provide a lot of money to help them out. First of all, when you approach it as a charity issue, it often leads to segregation. And segregation means that you're essentially holding people, people with disabilities are the poorest Americans in the United States. But if you put someone through a segregated system where they're in a separate school system and leading into a sheltered workshop, and they're not earning a salary, they're not paying taxes, they're dependent on government support. I mean, that's really an issue for society. And if we pose it as a social justice issue and a civil rights issue, and the fact that they have the right to be included, that inclusion will make us a better society, I think people will pay attention to that issue. The other issue that we try to talk about is the fact of the numbers, that if you're looking at 20% of the population as some form of disability, well, if you're involved in investing in improving your schools or the environment in your community, you can't really say it's fair to exclude 20% of the population. That's why I get back to the issue of networking. We're really working on networks because I think that's going to prove to society how extensive this population is and help amplify their voice. Yeah, the other thing,
well
Deborah,
said.
Before we go on to the next question, we have to look at the history of disability. At least in the United States, not so long ago, people with disabilities were institutionalized and locked away. And then we moved into a system of segregation where people were put into separate schools and separate housing and sheltered workshops. And we're sort of coming out of that, but we're not really out of that yet. And there's some very significant organizations out there that are making money and getting governmental support for segregation. In the United States, the administration, the Obama administration, has really been at the forefront in sort of pushing inclusion and going to the states and saying sheltered workshops are no longer going to be acceptable in our society, that federal contractors have to hire 7% of their workforce from people with disabilities. I mean, we need leadership like that. If I look at philanthropy or business or politics or whatever the industry is, you really need leadership on this issue. And the leadership can either come from a person in my position who's running the organization, or the leadership can come based on pressure that the disability community brings on the organization.
Yeah, well said, well said.
What about intrapreneurs? Because they're the other, I think they're the other key element within organizations, because we all agree it's a civil rights issue. We all agree that it needs leadership. These days, in the day of the networked organization, we live in much flatter structured organizations than ever before. I think that the intrapreneur is certainly something that can have a significant effect on changing the mindsets of people within organizations and help bring about that change.
Yeah, I think that's true. I mean, I think that we live in a society that values innovation, that values whether it's innovation in technology, whether it's innovation in ideas. And it's easy, at least through social media these days, to get ideas out there. And I think you do a lot with the media, working with reporters and writing. They're looking for innovation. They're looking for ideas and stories about how something that hasn't been done is being, you know, an issue is being solved. And to the extent that I see that when I meet people who I really think are changing society, those are people I want to know.
Okay. That's great. I know we're probably getting towards the end of our time. I just wanted to think about what you were saying around the way the companies were being affected, and certainly within our own organization we have a diversity policy, and disability is one of four strands of that policy. And effectively, we're not thinking about it as a charity issue. We're not thinking about it as a CSR issue. We're taking the view that to do this right, to integrate and make sure that we have diversity across age, culture, disability, etc., it's a performance issue. We're actually taking the view as an organization that if we don't do this, we are losing out on performance, and that, you know, performance is going to actually have an effect on our bottom line. And I think that's something that we need to get that message out more, because I know from the work that we do, myself, Deborah, etc., that when we enable people to work, make a fantastic contribution, they're good tax-paying, loyal employees that are often as productive, if not more so, than non-disabled employees. So it's really about pushing the message of organizational effectiveness. So I don't know how much time we've got left, but do you have another question?
I think we still have time for one more question.
Okay.
No, Jay, you were mentioning about an hackathon that you have organized. That those type of events are quite common in other areas, you know, people trying to develop startups, working about open data. It's very common to find hackathons in London, in New York, about all sorts of topics. What is your plan around that? Are you planning to bring those hackathons about accessibility and disability more global and to be something that could be done on different cities? What's your plan around that?
Well, we've done it so far in Tel Aviv, and we're looking to do it around our conference in Boston on November 1st and 2nd. You know, we're not the only ones doing it. I think that these hackathons are happening. And by the way, the work that's been done in 3D printing has been used to develop technology and you know, helping people access the job market. You know, I think it's a great idea, and I think that we're really focused as a society on solutions. I just want to move back and just say that even if you have the solutions, someone has to make that decision to hire that person, and that is often a change of attitude. And as I said, that change of attitude, we have to foster that change of attitude. It's not simply providing someone the technology that they can now access a PC and actually be in the workplace and contribute. You also have to convince that CEO or that HR department that that person deserves to work there. And I guess what we're involved in is sort of building facts on the ground, helping people get those jobs, and then having the employers become the greatest advocates for hiring, because then they know it works and they see the change that's happened in their workforce. So I think this all goes together. This is not a simple issue, as anyone involved knows. It's extremely complex, but we're all part of it. And what I'd like to say, and this is why I really appreciate social media, because whether we're in the position of a CEO or leading a philanthropic organization or in government, or just, you know, an activist out there somewhere in the world, we're all part of this solution, and we have to connect with each other. For me on social media, I enjoy it because I learn a lot and I connect with people who have the same mission. The downside for me in philanthropy is the exposure in people just saying, well, can you fund my project? And most of the times we can't, you know, because our funding is not unlimited like anyone's. So we have to sort of make a choice of where to invest. But I'm really focused on the networking right now, because I think the networking will bring this issue to a higher level. And I'm really cognizant of the fact that although I may have provided some leadership on this, I essentially only represent me and my family.
Thank you for your insights. We've hit our half hour. It's been really fascinating. Could go on for longer. I know I've got more questions. But we're going to close now, and we look forward to you joining us tomorrow on Twitter. I think it's going to be a fascinating Twitter chat. So thank you very much, Jack.
Thank you. This was great. Appreciate it.